Hello everybody, I'm Scotty from Scotty's Clock World.
This is the first video in a new series showcasing some of the clocks in my collection. I have over 200 clocks, all of them mechanical, either spring or weight driven. Mantle clocks, wall clocks, cuckoo clocks, alarm clocks, flip clocks and long case clocks. My collection includes antique French clocks, pre-war German clocks, English, American and German mid-century Art Deco clocks, also Japanese, Korean and even a Chinese clock. The company was founded in Schwenningen in southern Germany in the Black Forest area by Johannes Schlenker in 1822. This makes it the oldest watchmaking brand in Germany. The clock has an 8-day wind-up movement and the case is made from wood and was originally varnished. However, the varnish had seriously crazed, so I stripped it off and sanded the case back. Then I stained the case with rosewood stain before French polishing it to an even shine. The striking and chiming of the clock have a lovely resonance that you can hear from this clip. This clock is a Welch striking mantle clock. The shape of the case is referred to as architectural, with two colonnades on either side of the clock face. Elijah N. Walsh started making clocks in Forestville, Connecticut in 1809. But in 1899, two fires reduced most of the Welch manufacturing complex to ashes. In 1900, the wealthy Sessions family bought out many of the shareholders of the Welch company, and in 1902 took control of the company and changed the name to the Sessions Clock Company on January 09, 1903. The heavy wooden case gives the strike notes a deep resonance. This next clock is an 1873 French mantle clock made by Jappy Farrar, meaning the Jappy brothers. At that time, clock parts were manufactured by specialised workers in their homes throughout the countryside. Frederick Jappy changed the way clocks were made and assembled in France by bringing the workers into a large factory in Beaucourt that he owned. You can tell the movement is pre-1880s because it has an exposed count wheel on the back plate of the movement. After that date, the French used a rack and snail strike mounted on the front of the movement. However, there were minor exceptions to these dates. The case has been gilt with 24 karat gold leaf. The movement strikes on the original cup bell. The clock is normally covered by a large glass dome to protect it. This is a Betty Boop battery-powered wall clock from the late 70s to the early 80s. You can tell it's an original, not a recently made copy from China, because the pink-coloured outer bezel has faded over the years. New repros reproduce the original bright colour pink on the bezel, which is a complete giveaway. The clock has a stepper motor, which means the second hand jumps from 1 second to the next. It was only years later that clock battery movements were designed so that the second hand could sweep around the face of the clock with a smooth, continuous action. This clock hangs on a wall in our kitchen. This is another wall clock from our kitchen. There are no markings on the movement or on the case, so the brand is unknown, although the movement is definitely German in origin. The case is made of wood and has been ebonized before being hand painted with scrolls and floral scenes. It has a bim bam strike. This clock was manufactured by the Waterbury Clock Company in Waterbury, Connecticut, USA. The factory was developed in 1873 and remained the company's headquarters till 1944. The company's fortunes declined after World War I and it changed locations. From that date forth, the company was renamed the United States Time Corporation and is now known as the Timex Group. The company produced many different models: kitchen clocks, some with alarms, wall clocks, mantle clocks, and even architectural shaped clocks. This clock strikes the hours on a cup bell. This lovely little rosewood clock is a Jerome & Company time-only mantle clock. The company was started by Jerome and his son in 1816 to supply cheap clocks by mail order and was based in Plymouth, Connecticut, USA. The company produced mantle and wall clocks from 1845 to 1855 in New Haven when the company was declared bankrupt. This time-only wall clock was manufactured by the Ansonia Clock Company. The Ansonia Clock Company was founded in Connecticut in 1851 and later moved to Brooklyn and then New York in 1878. The Ansonia Clock Company was one of nine companies producing clocks in Connecticut. The company produced many hundreds of different clock models before finally closing its doors in 2006 after 155 years of continuous operation. In 1929, the majority of the timekeeping machinery was sold to the Soviet government's US trading company, Amtorg. This is a very rare Westclox Sphinx square alarm clock. It was manufactured in 1936 in the Westclox factory in Peterborough, Canada. The clock originally had a metallic brown lacquer finish over the case, which is made from nickel. The clock stands 4.5 inches tall. An electric version of the Sphinx was produced in 1951. There was also a wooden maple case version and an oak case version of the Sphinx. I will be servicing this alarm clock before long. It's been patiently sitting in my workshop for at least a year now, awaiting my attention. This clock was manufactured by the Waterbury Clock Company in Waterbury, Connecticut, in the early 1900s. The factory was developed in 1873 and remained the company's headquarters until 1944. The company's fortunes declined after World War I and it changed locations. From that date forth, the company was renamed the United States Time Corporation and is now known as the Timex Group. The company produced many different models: kitchen clocks, some with alarms, wall clocks, mantle clocks, and architectural shaped clocks. This is an original battery operated talking Mickey Mouse alarm clock from the 1980s. It was made by T&G under license from Disney. It features six different wake-up melodies, plus an animated voice saying good morning. Once again, there are very few examples of this talking alarm clock still able to be seen, as damaged models were thrown out when they became broken. This little clock is an example of an early quartz movement alarm clock made by the Copal Company Limited in Japan in the 1980s. It is model number HN164. Copal manufactured Japan's first digital clock, the Caslon 101. There were many Copal Caslon models, model 601 released in 1967, and model C61 released in 1973, and many more. The Nidec Copal Corporation was a Japanese company that produced the small electric motors that were used in the very popular flip clocks of the 1970s. Not only did Copal manufacture its own flip clocks, but they also supplied the motors used in many of the quality flip clocks made in the day. This is a lovely example of an Ansonia 8-day mantle clock. The fine porcelain case was produced by Royal Bonn in Germany. Royal Bonn produced fine porcelain between 1836 and 1931. We also have another Royal Bonn Ansonia mantle clock, blue in colour, that I will display later on. This is one of my Black Forest cuckoo clocks. It has a 30-hour movement. It is powered by two 275-gram weights and has a Chalet-style case. I am currently setting up a wall for my 30-hour and novelty Black Forest clocks and weather houses, and will display it later on. This is my desk clock. It's a space-age rhythm electric flip clock from the 1970s and is powered by a Copal electric motor. It was manufactured in Japan. Rhythm produced many different models and even a braille flip clock with small pins on the number tiles. This is a Mickey Mouse double bell alarm clock made under license from Disney by Avronel in Germany in the 1970s. It has a plastic case with a metal backplate and metal bells on the top of the case. These clocks are worth more than $300 in Australia now, as they were thrown out when they broke back in the day. Thus, there are very few of them left around today. However, cheap Chinese knockoffs are readily available at markets and other places, so it pays to be aware of this and keep a lookout for the fakes. This Sessions architectural clock was the first clock that I bought and the one I started learning clock repairs on. Also, it was the one that started me collecting clocks all those years ago. It has an 8-day movement and strikes the hour and half hours on a coil gong. In 1902, the Sessions family purchased the E.N. Welch Company in Connecticut. At the time, William E. Sessions owned a factory in Bristol, Connecticut, that made cases for Ian Welch. In 1930, Sessions started producing electric clocks. The Great Depression caused Sessions to stop the production of spring-wound clocks in 1936. This is an unusual Ansonia clock. It has an 8-day movement and a subsidiary dial down the bottom that counts the seconds. What makes it unusual is that it's a very heavy, it's 1.2 kilos, brass cased clock. That's a winding key, of course. And that's the fast slow adjustment on it. But it's covered in copper, burnished copper, made by the Ansonia Company in New York. And it's the only one of those I've ever seen. I've never seen another copper covered clock of any description. Not going at the moment, it's waiting to be serviced, but 8-day clocks are quite rare. So that'll come up for service pretty soon. There it is, Ansonia copper covered clock. This is the Sessions Bim Bam clock. The configuration of the case is called an Admiral's Hat. Unfortunately, most people call this shape on any clock made by any manufacturer a Napoleon hat. But in actual fact, it isn't. There was one French clock made in 1823 that was called a Napoleon hat, and this is not that shape. This is an Admiral's hat. All right, let's listen to it. Here's another quite unusual clock. It's a very small clock. As you can see, it's about 7 inches, 7.5 inches at the top of the finial. It's made of slate, pillar on either side, an architectural or a temple shaped clock. It's got a standard 2-inch movement in it. I'll turn it round, you can see that. There it is there, winding key, time setting knob. It's also quite heavy, weighs over a kilo. Little brass finial on the top that you can see there. It's made of slate, that's why it's so heavy, black slate. And it has a dome on top, made of liver marble. A most unusual clock. You don't very often see miniature clocks like that. I saw it about 3 years ago in an antique collectible shop for $90, and it was too much, and I decided not to buy it. It's a lovely little clock. I've redone the gold down there. That was a bit faded when it was purchased, but I decided not to buy it. It was too expensive, and we were going through the same town. A year later, I dropped in and had a look at what they had in there, and the clock was still there. So it was obviously waiting for me to come back and pick it up. So I bought it home, serviced it, cleaned it up, re-gilt the bottom down there and the top patterns. And that's what it looks like today.